and for the last 3 years because I am trying to uncover forgeries outside of Rockland County that I believe are coming out of the surrogate court using deceased people's names. I am being targeted by the judges and district attorney's office in Rockland County. The gentleman, Gary Casale, says that my complaint of my former defense attorney being promoted to the district attorney's office in the middle of my case, now being a district attorney, a senior district attorney in the Rockland County district attorney's office, for 4 months after he swore the oath of office, he acted as my defense attorney on my criminal matter in the same court he's sworn to be a prosecutor with. I have a sworn oath of office in that package. I have forgeries with naming a person, named forgeries out of the Rockland County, out of Rockland County with a handwriting analysis expert's opinion on there who forged those documents. There's more in that. My daughter, they kept me away from my daughter with illegal court orders, saying that I can't see my 17-year-old daughter, where she wrote letters to the court asking the judge for unrestricted visitation with her father. The judge ignored those. I am being retaliated against in Rockland County. They recently incarcerated me as a first-time offender for harassment as a retired New York City policeman for 14 days in jail with a $250 fine. No docket of that decision in order. The only thing on the docket is that I paid a fine and I paid restitution. Everything in Rockland County when it comes to my case in that package, sir, is fraudulent in nature to cover up for the crimes that the lawyers and judges in that county are committing. And I'm being retaliated against it. If somebody would look at that package and hear what I'm saying, you will find that's undisputable evidence. Like I tell you, a three-year litigation in Rockland County Court with no docket. I'm in a court right now for criminal charges going back 3 years ago. No grand jury. No indictment, no anything. And for 3 years later, they reduced the charge to harassment and want to send me to jail, right on the brink of me coming to this hearing, because they want to stop me from coming here.
Well, I mean, I'm glad you made it here, and I will make sure that we go through this and get a response back to you very quickly.
And all the committee letters are on front that are all rubber stamps. We see nothing. We see no problems. They always have like a catchphrase.
Okay.
Your complaint doesn't fall in our jurisdiction, et cetera, et cetera. But based on following those complaints is facts, sir, that you can verify. And there is corruption, and it's happening now. And you can catch these people.
Thank you very much, Ms. Kelly. I'll make sure we definitely follow it up. Thank you. The next witness is Catherine Grace Jordan of New York. Kind of moving here, so I like.
I know. good afternoon, Your Honor. I'm here to talk about the Commission on Judicial Conduct. By way of background, though, I do want to identify myself as the president of END and Discrimination Now, an organization that I started in 2008 after it became apparent to me that our nations and states' anti-discrimination laws are not being enforced by the judiciary, and that many activist judges are actually rewriting the laws on a regular basis. I myself endured a 13-year litigation, a disability discrimination case. 10 years of that litigation resulted in a jury verdict in my favor, which was reversed by the first department under Jonathan Lippman. I believe I have stepped back because my training is as a management consultant and Fortune 100 executive, and I've done a thorough analysis of all the information that's available, including Mr. Tembekian's 2009 annual report and all the data that's in it.
So what's your analysis?
Well, I will tell you this. I don't think there's anything to be proud of. First of all, judicial misconduct is up. And he talks about managing, just 1 second, I got to flip the page. He talks about, you know that things are very bad when you have to refer to 30 years' worth of work and 69,000 complaints over 30 years. What he didn't focus on was the 1,923 new complaints that are up 12% from last year, which is part of the evidence that shows that the rules of judicial conduct are not being enforced, but either in district court or at the appellate level, despite the increase in complaints, because judges, and as I've just said, are not enforcing the laws, and the Judicial Misconduct Commission is not doing their job in terms of reviewing the conduct of these judges. And they talked about the fact that they have 22 commission attorneys and 12 commission members, and the fact that you gave them extra money. I don't know what they've been doing with it, but obviously they haven't been doing it to thoroughly review complaints and to make sure that these judges are held accountable. One of the most astounding statistics is that there were 40 complaints against appellate judges and zero were investigated. If you take Mr. Tembekian at his word, at his face value, they're doing a bang-up job, and we have a bunch of delusional litigants who are just populating the system with meritless complaints. I don't believe that's the case. I think what's going on is that we have a crisis of leadership in the judiciary and a culture of corruption and cover-ups, and I believe that the Commission on Judicial Conduct is part of that. Mr. Tembekian, and I wanted to ask a couple of questions to him when he was in the room before, one of which is, does he still have his cable television show where he interviews judges and lawyers? Because that's kind of a conflict of interest with your current position. And how he goes about conducting investigations, because I myself have filed several complaints with the Judicial Conduct Commission, very, very meritorious complaints where judges expressly violated, either through ex parte conduct, acting, making, attacking.
Those complaints were dismissed or never followed up with?
They were dismissed almost like within a month, a couple months, no explanation. The process is not transparent. It's all secretive. And as far as appeals, the appeals, as he's just admitted, only are for the benefit of the judges. It is in my opinion, the Judicial Commission on Misconduct has numerous problems. I'm going to list them very quickly. Lack of transparency, conflicts of interest, the composition of the actual commission itself, the investigators who actually on paper, many of which seem to have good qualifications, which kind of creates an interesting question, which is why can't they resolve these investigations positively and in a timely manner. There's actually no interaction with the complainant, so you have no idea what's going on. The priorities seem to be on routing the town and village errant judges while letting the big fish swim away. I don't know how they handle evidence. I know there's a huge issue about evidence handling that has been spoken about by a number of people in this room, and it's very serious. If you go to 60 Center Street, you will know the lack of integrity that exists in terms of files. Anybody can walk in, take a file out, and there is nothing that can be done about it. I mean, there's no proof, nothing. What has to happen is the files need to be digitized. But
So basically summing it up, Ms. Jordan.
Yes. I've talked faster than anybody up here.
Correct. And that's why, because you seem to be very specific in what you want.
Right.
That's what I'm looking for, the recommendations.
Yes.
I think
that a task force should be formed to review whether or not the Commission on Judicial Conduct is an effective body.
Task force, who do you think should be comprised of this task force?
I am not going to make specific recommendations here, Your Honor, because I don't have enough time to do that, but I will get back to you with that. I do believe, though, that we need a multi-stakeholder task force to investigate whether or not the Commission on Judicial Conduct is doing its job, and if it's not, what kind of entity might replace it.
Sure.
Because we definitely need to monitor the judges and make sure that they are enforcing the laws, because it appears that they're not doing it at the moment.
Sure. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
The next witness is James. How do you pronounce your last name, James?
Montagnino.
Montagnino.
Can I object? Because I have personal knowledge of his criminal activities.
There's no objection right here. We're going to let Mr.
Montagnino
make his comments. And if you have comments to make, if you're on the list, then we can listen to your comments. Or we can talk to me after this is over, and then we can follow up. Okay?
Thank you very much.
Yes.
Thank you, Senator. I just want to begin by saying that I don't have an axe to grind. I'm not here with a specific gripe about anything in particular with regard to myself on a personal level. I've been an employee of the Unified Court System since 1995. I've been a court attorney referee for the last 10 years. I started out my legal career in the Bronx District Attorney's Office. I was a prosecutor in the Westchester DA's office. I was a legal aid lawyer in Westchester. I was principal law clerk to a county judge for 5 years in Westchester. The last 3 years, I've been a court attorney referee here in the Capital District, and I love my job. And one thing I've learned in years in the judiciary is that with every decision a judge makes, that judge makes one temporary friend and one permanent enemy. And this is something that really has to be considered when weighing the probative value of complaints that are made against judges over the course of the years. I can say with pride that my experience in the Capital District, the Third Judicial District, has been wonderful over the last 3 years. As a court attorney referee, I'm assigned to the chambers of various judges on a rotating basis. I've worked with Supreme Court justices, Court of Claims judges, county judges, a family court judge, some city court judges. I've been all around the Third District. And I can say categorically that the judges of this district do their jobs to the best of their ability. They are hardworking. They are ethical people. And one of the reasons, one of the big reasons for that, is that the administrative judge for this district, George Cerezia, is a man of the highest moral and ethical caliber. And he sets the tone for the way business is conducted in this district. Having said that, I'm here because in the 7 years that I worked as a court attorney referee assigned to the matrimonial part in Westchester County, that same condition did not apply to Westchester County. That for years in Westchester, I, having been assigned to matrimonial cases, saw on a regular basis that the district administrative judge entertained ex parte communications from well-connected attorneys and well-connected litigants, and those ex parte communications often resulted in transfers of cases from one judge to another. In one case, the change of a decision that a judge had already signed and sent out to the parties based upon ex parte communications. I saw this for years and finally decided that I had to take action. And I brought an internal complaint to the various chief administrative judges in the Office of Court Administration. And the result of that was retaliation against me, not by OCA, but by the target, by the administrative judge. I'm going to cut through some of the details and get to the point what brings me here today, Senator. I can certainly understand the Commission on Judicial Conduct taking a jaundiced eye looking at a complaint brought by a litigant who lost a case in court. In Westchester County, I filed a complaint ultimately with the Commission on Judicial Conduct that was detailed. It named names, it gave cases, it gave dates. Attached to it were photographs of dumpsters of court records that were ordered destroyed. Matrimonial files by law must be retained permanently. They were destroyed. It would have been one thing if I had been the only complainant, Senator. But a retired acting justice of the Supreme Court, Fred L. Shapiro, sent his own complaint to the Commission on Judicial Conduct against the same administrative judge, Judge Francis Nicolai, alleging the same kinds of abuses, naming names, giving dates, giving information that he had on personally obtained. And it wasn't just the two of us, Senator. There was a third individual, the principal law clerk to a Supreme Court justice in the 9th Judicial District, Barry Swirsky, sent his own complaint to the Commission on Judicial Conduct with his information on routine, regular, consistent patterns of misconduct whereby Judge Nicolai would steer cases when a lawyer who had the right connections didn't like the way his matrimonial case was being handled. He could go to Judge Nicolai without, of course, opposing counsel having any idea of it, explain the fact that he had a problem with the judge who was assigned to the case, and lo and behold, the case would be reassigned to a more sympathetic judge. There were written complaints. A law guardian who was involved in a child custody proceeding where the judicial hearing officer who was presiding over that case ordered that the father have the right to see his children and made it so under supervised conditions to protect everybody's safety. That litigant went ex parte to Judge Nicolai, and Judge Nicolai told that judicial hearing officer to change his decision. He did that and then complained about it. The law guardian, the attorney for the children in that case, wrote a letter herself to Judge Nicolai and said to him, you can't do this. This is improper. This is the worst of ex parte communications. And what did that law guardian get for her troubles? That letter that was sent to Judge Nicolai, he forwarded on to the woman who is in charge of the law guardian panel with a cover letter saying, for whatever action you deem appropriate. The bottom line, Senator, is that without a hearing, without an investigation, without any contact with any of the three members of the court system and retired member of the court system who brought the complaints, no contact with us, no documents subpoenaed, no documents requested, no information requested, no testimony taken, no witnesses put under oath. The Commission on Judicial Conduct, in one sentence, dismissed all three complaints against Judge Nicolai, and that was the end of the matter, with no accountability, no explanation, no transparency. And so I think, Senator, that at the very least, Mr. Tembekian himself mentioned it this morning, and the Commission has year after year in their annual report themselves asked for it, open up the proceedings to the public. Why should this be secret? Judges are public officials. They have a public trust. Many of our judges are elected officials. The public has a right to know how complaints against judges are handled. I'm sensitive to the concerns that many judges have because of the fact that they are either appointed or elected officials, that abuses can occur, that frivolous complaints can be lodged for purposes of political gain, or, as happens very, very often, most of the complaints, I'm sure Mr. Tembekian will confirm, most of the complaints come from litigants who simply lost. I know from personal experience, having presided over contested matrimonial cases for 7 years, every day of the week, Monday to Friday, you know, you can imagine, Senator, it's human nature. If I make a ruling that says this parent will have custody of the child and the other parent will not, how often do you think the parent who loses goes home and says, well, I'm just an unfit parent and that's why I lost? That's not the way it works. We know that. So it's so common, particularly in family cases, custody cases and matrimonial cases, the litigant who loses frequently will try to blame someone. It's my lawyer's fault. My lawyer did something wrong. It's the judge's fault. The judge did something wrong. Most of the time we know that's not so. The problem is, though, when you have in with those thousands of complaints that get dismissed without investigation, where you have a complaint that wasn't brought by a disgruntled litigant or a disgruntled former employee, but brought by three people on the inside of the court system who give information with dates and names and places and photographs and copies of documents, and it's just tossed aside.
My question to you is, I'm assuming there was some sort of retaliation because of these allegations that you made, correct?
Yes.
And that resulted into negative evaluations, is that correct?
No, Senator. I've never had a negative evaluation. In fact, what happened, since you asked the question, I didn't want to get into personal things, but I'm glad to do that. Judge Nicolai essentially opened his file of every complaint that any litigant who wasn't happy with the result of their matrimonial cases had with me. And he gave that over to the Inspector General for the Unified Court System. I went through about a month and a half of hell having to answer for every decision that anybody had a question about. Why did you rule this way? Why did you say this? Did you say this? Did you talk to this litigant? Did you not talk to this litigant? I had to answer.
That was a form of retaliation.
At the end, the head of human relations said to me, orally, I got nothing in writing. She said, I want you to know there have been no negative findings against you. And your personnel file, she gave me a full copy of the personnel file. She said, it will not even reflect the fact that an investigation had ever been taken against you.
And I think being that, no, if you have complaints with individuals on the inside, you would probably want to look at that a little bit closer because of the positions that you have.
But there was a little bad news attached. I got transferred.
You got transferred up to what?
Well, I was ordered transferred to Bronx County. And I made an arrangement. I said, look, I'd rather be transferred where we have our second home up in Saratoga Springs. We love upstate New York. If you can do that, it'll be voluntary. If I'm forced to go elsewhere, then I'd consider that a retaliatory employment act under the whistleblower law, and you know where it would go from there would be something else. And they were kind enough, they accommodated the request, and so I voluntarily transferred up here.
Okay. I got 5 minutes. I know.
I'd like to know what happened to my transcript for you. Okay.
Gentlemen, you know, you don't have, you don't have the floor? Hello? Hello? We're trying to be courteous here. You don't have the floor. Mr. Montanino, thank you very much for your testimony here today.
Thank you, Senator.
And if I could just have a two-minute break. I have to make a quick phone call. Two-minute break. We're going to have the next witness. I guess the next witness could come up, Ruth Pollack. I just have a two-minute break, make a phone call, and I'll be right back. Yeah, I'm going to try to cut up about 3:30. All right, we're getting ready to start. Ruth Pollack, Ms. Pollack, go right ahead.
Good afternoon, Senator. Thank you very much. My name is Ruth Pollack. I'm an attorney in the east end of Long Island, Riverhead, New York. Practiced 26, going on 27 years. I have had I love my career, and I have had a wonderful career. I've practiced in just about every court that you can practice in. I've tried cases in surrogates court and took a verdict at 2 o'clock in the morning and won. I have been in the state and federal courts and agencies, and I'm a former prosecutor for the Nassau DA about 26, 27 years ago. There's not much I haven't seen and done. And for the most part, I love what I do, and I look forward to any new attorney or judge that I meet. I'm here today, however, because of the breakdown of the system and my brief suggestions for what I think, as a member of the brothers and sisters in law in the trenches, we can do to fix it. I got ovarian cancer in June of 2003. I went through the full Monty, and I survived that. I'm now considered cured, even though I still suffer from lymphedema in both my legs. That means I carry 60 pounds of extra fluid in my legs every day, so I'm partially physically disabled. And, of course, as a survivor, we don't seek sympathy. We just want understanding and some accommodation. I'm just happy to be here and happy to be alive. But I tried a case in Eastern District Federal Court against the U.S. government, and many of my cases despite my stature, I go up against some big league people. I go up the federal government. I've gone up against banking institutions, many school districts, and so forth. I have an asbestos case involving a school district on Long Island right now. My cases are controversial, and I'm not afraid to go after anyone, including an attorney, if the attorney is doing something that is improper. When I returned back into active duty, so to speak, as an attorney, the case that I had against the federal government was partly on account of my disability, dismissed in the middle of my direct examination of, I must have been through about 8 to 10 witnesses at that point, and that was on June 5th, 2007. That led to a contempt hearing, and I was held in contempt of court, and I'll move on to that, move on from there. The very next day, I walked into an ongoing family court case in Manhattan Family Court, the Jubb case, J-U-B-B, representing a father and his infant son, or actually I represented the father on behalf of him and his son. And I'd been there many times before. I'd objected to what I saw was tampering of witnesses by Child Protective Services, tampering with records. The general poorly run court room and poorly run proceedings. And at 9:30 in the morning in family court at 60 Lafayette, and at the beginning of a hearing before Judge Susan Nips, a male court officer proceeded to come toward me without provocation. He placed me in a forward and a front headlock before I was able to sit down. And the 10 or so court officers that were already in the courtroom when I walked in, of that group, about 5 of them came around me from behind and put me in a full body lock, lifted me from the floor, dragged me out, crashed me against the wall, and then threw me out into the court lobby, physically, bodily. Everyone, I have lay witnesses and I have my client and other witnesses to this occurrence. Everyone in the courtroom, the judge, and everyone denied that it happened. I had done nothing. The judge said, clear the courtroom now, when I had simply said to the court officer, I have 2 witnesses, they're not testifying, and that's all they said. As a result, I suffered tremendous post-traumatic stress syndrome. I never walked into a courtroom again feeling the same safety and security that I had for 26 years. I filed a case against the state of New York, which is pending with the Attorney General's office. I had hoped, and I'm hoping, that the Attorney General will investigate this. But then it continued because thereafter, on September 28th of 2007, when I went back to that court, to the financial judicial hearing officer for the monetary portion of the case, the record was shut off by the JHO, and the court officers slammed my desk against the wall and told me to get up and my client and get out. And they surrounded us, but they didn't touch us. I took the badge numbers as well. So it was more internal terrorism, so to speak. I had never before been attacked by anyone in my lifetime. So this was, again, more of a message of some sort. I'm not sure what. Since that time, I've been menaced by court officers on behalf of 2 judges in district court in Hempstead in a criminal case, because I do a lot of criminal defense work, and that has caused me great consternation. I've had witnesses to that occurrence as well. I have witnesses. I'm here because, while I could go on and on about my long career and my curricula vitae is up there for you and for the panel, the system is breaking down. We need to fix it. It's worthy of that. My father was a top gun in the Second World War, and I still have him today, and it's because of him and our foremothers and forefathers that we're here today, able to speak out about how we feel about this country and our state. And I'm here to be part of the solution, not part of the problem. And I will do everything that I can to be part of the solution, which is a huge, huge, in need of huge help. I personally am now, I've been suspended for 2 years. It started out with a 45-day suspension with a threat of 6 months incarceration. And I served my 45 days of suspension in the Eastern District of New York because I disagreed with a judge and because I missed a day of court due to my legs. I went to two federal courthouses in the Eastern District, neither of which are ADA compliant. I have complained about it. Nothing's been done. So that my disabled clients, who are also whistleblowers, and I have difficulty parking to get to those courthouses. I'm moving rather rapidly because I just want to hit on certain points that I think people should know. Since that time, I have had, since the federal suspension which I served, I was advised rather cryptically that they thought that I had violated my 45-day suspension by using my former law partner to cover my cases for me, one case for me. And so they just sent me a letter saying, you haven't responded in 20 days, so we're going to suspend you for 2 years now.
Who's this?
Only in the Eastern District. That was Judge Kogan. They claim that there is an Eastern District of New York grievance committee, but I have never seen
any such
thing. So you were
suspended from practicing in the Eastern District?
Only for 2 more years. That's where almost all of my cases are. One of my clients is here in the audience today, Mr. Kevin Chesney. Again, that was to put me out of business. That was to get rid of me. My own appointed attorney told me to give up all my cases in the Eastern District, submit to urine tests, and or else I would go to jail. And that would be the best thing she could do. She accused me of being mentally ill, something I am clearly not. So I was essentially put in a position where they were going to have me suspended to get me out of the Eastern District, come hell or high water.
Right.
And that's where I am today, fighting all the way to come back. And that is a fight for another day. But the point is that now the Eastern District has sent paperwork behind the scenes, without my knowing what it is, to the 10th Judicial District where I am, where I reside. And Rita Adler, who is the chief counsel there, has bombarded me with letter after letter after letter after letter, day after day after day, relating to that case in which I was held in contempt in 2007, saying that she thinks I'm a criminal and I should be treated as a criminal and I shouldn't be allowed to practice and we should do something about this woman.
I mean, when you say she didn't write you a letter to that extent.
She wrote a letter to Mr. Peltzer to that effect.
Not calling you a criminal.
What she did was criminal, essentially, is what she says in her letter, and that's in part of my packet.
Okay.
Basically
okay.
Saying, yeah, it's her actions are criminal, they're, you know, quite strong. Actually citing to sections of the penal law, and as a criminal defense attorney and former prosecutor, I'm very well acquainted with the penal law. So part of her approach, if we may look at how rules are to be followed, is she pretended, as did a member of the 10th, that she couldn't reach me or serve me. So an investigator came to my home, left a business card in my door, which could have floated off into the atmosphere. My 86-year-old father saw that, saw orders slipped under the door, and one day when I walked into my office in 2008, I was met with an order that was taped to my door with red masking tape. I'm holding it up now, which I took a picture of and blew up so that you could see the door of my office. I walked, everybody in my office building saw this, my suite with this red masking tape, I don't know where you get it, but
right,
taped to my door. So again, these terror tactics, or whatever you want to call them, have been used to intimidate me and to make me go away. I may just be a country girl from the East End, but I do not go away. I have always fought for the underdog my whole life. I've seen injustices since I was a kid. And I do not discriminate. I represent everybody. I don't care who or what the person is about. I represent them all. Mr. Kelly in Rockland is my newest client. I'm an outsider. I'm a new kid on the block. I've seen what he has described. It is a fact. I have never had any problems in my life of any kind, criminal or otherwise, other than one incident with the grievance committee back in the late 90s involving a matrimonial, which was clearly a political way of getting a case, a very, very interesting case involving the Manises, Morton Manis, a matrimonial away from me when it was going rather well, and given to another attorney. And because I stood up for my retaining lien and I was in the middle of a retaining lien hearing, I was had charges brought up against me, but my case was transferred to the 9th district that didn't know me at all.
Right.
So that's my, that was my first foray into the 9th.
So if you want to sum it up, Ms. Powell.
My summary is that the solution to these many things that you've heard today, without my repeating the many things that we've heard as a group here, is that we need transparency, and the transparency must look like this. We need transparency in terms of judges and all public officials that serve in our system and on these committees should disclose what insurance companies insure them, what financial institutions they have their pensions or finances in through the system, what banks are involved, what disability insurance companies are involved. Because when I've sued these various types of companies, I've never known if there was a conflict of interest between those people that I was working in front of as judges or against as litigants, if there was a conflict of interest. So I highly, highly support full disclosure of any and all of those types of things on the docket, including all committee members on all of the committees we've discussed today, who they are, where they're from, all of their affiliations, what their trainings are. I can't find any of it, and I've looked all over the place. Who were the people on the committee? Where did they come from, et cetera? And I don't think I need to go on. I think it's a point that's been taken.
Thank you very much.
And I just wanted to thank you sincerely for your time.
Thank you very much.
God bless.
Thank you very much. The next witness is Lawrence Gray. Mr. Gray, you here? Mr. Gray is not here. Lawrence Gray. Okay, great. Ken Jewell, Esquire. Mr. Jewell, you here? Mr. Jewell is not here. Kevin Patrick Brady.
Senator, I want you to remember me as being the one guy who used as less time as possible to tell you my story, and we'll move on. I haven't heard yet today my kind of a case. I am a non-lawyer. I have been prosecuted criminally 3 times, incarcerated, prosecuted in quasi-criminal prosecutions 2 times, and not one of these courts had jurisdiction. Now, the Assistant Attorney General managed to shove through a money judgment against me that's not valid, and I have been petitioning courts for the last 6 years to recognize that these judgments are void. They must be taken off my record. I showed proof every time that the judgments were void, and no court today has done one thing about it. Now, I'm talking about the 4th Department, talking about the 1st Department, and the 3rd Department. The petitions and appellate briefs that I filed were enunciated these issues perfectly. It could not be mistaken. I believe that they all just dumped them. They didn't read the petition, or they read it just far enough to hear me complaining about corruption in the courts. And that's all they needed to know. I have been, like I told you, petitioning courts. I've got in excess of 30 trying to get those 2 or 3 issues across. 1, the courts never had jurisdiction. 2, the judgments are void. And 3, the Assistant Attorney General has absolutely no authority to be prosecuting me under judiciary law for his own fraud. In all of those actions, not one single issue has been adjudicated. So I have given you proof. I've put them on CDs. Right. It's all there. The system is corrupted far beyond what anyone can really imagine.
Okay.
I really encourage you to take a look at my proof because it's prima facie. Okay?
Definitely.
And
we will definitely do that, Mr. Brady.
Thank you.
I give you my word. Thank you very much, Mr. Brady. The next witness is Carl
Lanzazera.
Mr. Lanzazera.
How you doing? if you
okay.
When you go in the subway, you see a sign that says
we're going to just want to lay by about 2:45. We're going to take a break for another 15 minutes, and then I'll be back. I just want to check into session. Okay.
Somebody left their pen.
Lanzazera, Mr. Lanzazera.
Yes, Carl.
No. Yeah. What's up? Got another 8 minutes. Let's go ahead.
If you go in a subway, you see a sign. If you see something, say something. If you go in the airports, if you see something, say something. If you go to a marina, they say, if you see something, say something. If you go in the courts and you see something and you say something, that's the worst day of your life. And everybody is here with that same gripe. The first two speakers, Martin and Alan, they really should have a Broadway skit because they're two jokers. Either they don't have...
Mr. Lanzazera, you know, Mr. Lanzazera, I understand it, but everybody's... listen to me, please. Everybody here is afforded the courtesy and respect. No character assassinations. This is a public hearing to get to the issues because we want solutions.
Well, I was arrested for telling jokes, so...
Yeah. We don't want to arrest you, all right?
Okay. They had a grand jury hearing. I told lawyer jokes. But I'm in the investment business 45 years. In the investment business, if you have a complaint, you go to now FINRA or the NASD, it's called, or the SEC. Can you imagine if the SEC or FINRA was run by stockbrokers? What would happen after 40 years, 50 years? Bernie Madoff would probably get 6 months in jail. The legal profession is run by lawyers for 100 years. The first thing the grievance committee did when they were assigned to uphold the Constitution of the United States was to give themselves judicial immunity. Even you don't have judicial immunity. You have to answer to us. But they don't have to answer to anyone. In the securities business, if you have a complaint against a stockbroker, you go to the NASD for a few dollars, and you have a public hearing before three panelists. The panel, their complete history is listed, where they eat, where they sleep, what cases they have, and you have a right to eliminate any of the three panelists, if there's a slightest inkling. With the grievance committee, you have no idea who the commission is and what they're doing. The hearings are all public. The findings are more than 60% of the cases the public gets an award. Now, with your own...
And which proceeding is this? This is
in NASD,
okay,
or FINRA, in mandatory arbitration. And if there's a finding against you, it's made public, not only in the state that you operate in, but throughout the world. 35 years ago, there was a finding I didn't buy a stock at the best price, and I had to give someone $250. 35 years later, if you look up my Social Security number, you will see it on my record. If there's a finding against me and they ever took my license away, it would be throughout the United States. In the legal profession, if there's a finding in New York State, the lawyer can go to New Jersey, get his license, over there and practice law in New York. They can't. They claim they can't follow the lawyer and his past history. That's a bunch of malarkey. That's why I made the original comments that I made. There's no reason in today's day and age you can't follow someone with a Social Security number throughout the world. The findings are public. The hearings are public. You face your accused. You defend yourself. You know exactly what they say. As a result of my personal history, I started a group, Americans for Legal Reform. If you look at it, that's our newsletter. I've been doing this for more than 20 years. In there, you see a list of lawyers and judges that we have found that do things that we feel are questionable. We can't say what they do because, as your senator friend to your left from Syracuse, one of his lawyer friends in Syracuse sued me for libel by innuendo. There's only maybe three cases in the world of libel by innuendo, and I had to spend $100,000 defending myself because I put his name on that list, and he felt he was damaged. They're so afraid of their reputation. Why are they any different than a stockbroker or a plumber? If I go to Consumer Affairs and there are 500 complaints against a plumber, I can look at them all and evaluate whether they're frivolous or real. If you want to open an account with a stockbroker, you should check with FINRA and find out his history. But if you're a lawyer, as Jack Solowitz, my divorce attorney, one of my divorce attorneys, stole millions from 49 people. The 49th didn't know about the 48th. The 48th didn't know about the 47th, and so on. Eventually, he did go to jail. And when he comes out of jail, he could have been a lawyer again. It's all a secret. It's the only profession that's a secret. It's a bunch of malarkey about their reputation. The lawyers as a group are considered the most criminal group in America. Their position in life is less than New York City taxi cab driver. And they're trying to, by secrecy, protect themselves. It's a good old boy brotherhood that somebody has to stop. And if it's not stopped by people like you, the public is not going to take it forever.
Mr. Lazar, I thank you very much for that comment. Ladies and gentlemen, I'm going to take about a 15-minute break. I have to register in session, and I'll be back to conclude these hearings. Thank you very much. 15 minutes. Thank you, sir. Of course.